love baptizing people. Every time I think I'm tired and I don't want to do this job anymore, somebody wants to be baptized, have their baby baptized, and I'm like, okay, I'm back, I'm back. Okay, I'm going to tell you a secret. This got me in trouble once. I got in trouble more than once, but this is a good example of me getting in trouble preaching. It was Easter Sunday, too. I don't know why it came out of my mouth like it did, because it was my sermon title was, "What Are You Looking For?" When we go to the tomb, what do you look for at the tomb on Easter morning? Because the women went looking for a corpse and they found an empty tomb. And one of the things I said, if you're looking for prosperity, if you're looking for a lot of money, a better looking house, better looking wife, better looking car, bigger this, bigger that, I said, go to Joel Osteen because you're not going to find it at the tomb. Somebody left the church over that because they said, Joel Osteen is a holy man. He may be a holy man, but he's very wrong theologically, I got to tell you. Because the prosperity gospel says what? If you believe in God, what's going to happen to you? Everything good is going to come rolling down the pike your way. How many of you have had everything good happen to you every moment of your life from the time you believed in Jesus Christ? It doesn't work that way, does it? Which is why I also don't believe in the idea of the American sort of, what does they call it? What do they call it now? The United States being the manifest destiny, I lost the words. They were right here in my head, and they're gone right now. You know what I mean, don't you? When you have, Marjorie Taylor Greene says it all the time, that we're what? Sorry about that. See, I needed prayer this morning because my brain just shut right down. Dum, 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 dum. I'll come back to that, okay? But we tend to think that everything's going to go our way if we believe, and that is not what Jesus is saying here. Because how many of you would choose the crown or the cross? Which would you choose, having the crown or the cross? We'd all choose the crown, let's say it, but we got to pick up our cross and walk. That's what Jesus says here, right? And also, what else does he say there? He says all sorts of things to Peter, but let's go back and look at from that time on, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go into Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and the chief priests and scribes and be killed. Peter says, From that time on, what did Peter just do last week? Now, you remember last week's sermon, don't you? This week's lesson? Jesus said to the disciples, who are people saying that I am? Well, some say that you're Elijah, some say Jeremiah, some say John the Baptist. Then he says, who do you say that I am? And what did Peter say? You are what? The Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said, I can build a rock on that. On that rock, I can build a church. He said, you're Peter, the rock. I can build my church on that foundation. Today, what's he saying to him? He's gone from rock to stumbling block. Sort of a big fall, isn't it? Because Peter is a hot mess sometimes, just like we are, right? So here we are again with Peter. He said the right thing last week, and God said what? What did Jesus say to him when he said, you're the Messiah, the Son of the living God? He said, now that came from God. That didn't come from any of your experience with Peter. You couldn't have gotten there on your own. But Peter turned to God and said, you are the Son of the living God. You are the Messiah. And today he says, don't say that, Lord. Don't say that. God forbid. La, 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 la. I don't want to hear it, Lord. You can't die. Which is why at the end of last week's lesson, what did Jesus say when he said, now that you know that I'm Messiah, don't tell anybody. What do they expect the Messiah to be? What kind of Messiah were they expecting? A king, a warrior, another David, a larger-than-life comic book kind of hero, somebody written by Marvel Comics or DC Comics, somebody that big and bold and bigger than life. And instead they got Jesus. But they go to the Last Supper. What are they thinking of the Last Supper? He's about to kick Rome's behind right on out of the Holy Land. About to establish the kingdom again. Everything's going to go their way. Is that what happened? No, Jesus was nailed to a cross. He knows that they're not ready to hear it yet, but he starts to teach them from that time on. He must go to Jerusalem, undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes, be killed, and on the third day be raised. Peter takes him aside and says, God forbid it, Lord. This will never happen to you. But he turned to Peter and said, get behind me, Satan. You're a stumbling block. Pretty big deal from the rock to the stumbling block, isn't it? In one fell swoop. That's Satan. That's pretty harsh, isn't it? Does he think Peter's evil? No. He thinks Peter's human. But if you look back at the beginning of this gospel, and remember I said Matthew's gospel was written particularly to the Jewish audience to show them that this was the the promised Messiah that they had been waiting for. They just thought they were waiting for somebody different. But who appears to Jesus in the wilderness and offers him all sorts of things if he'll just be, if he'll leave God and worship him? Satan. What was Jesus offered in the wilderness? Do you remember? He was taken to the top of the temple. If you throw yourself down, the angels will come and protect you. Because Satan knows the scriptures just as well or better than we do sometimes. And then he says, shows them all the kingdoms of the world, says, I'll give them all of you. I'll give them all to you. They'll worship you if you just bow down and worship me. Jesus says, nope, and that's the end of it. And Peter's offering Jesus something else, a different way, saying, if you're the Son of God and the Messiah, you could just tell everything what to do and everything would obey you. So why would we go through this suffering and death business? I don't want to hear it. Jesus says the words that still he says to his followers today. Just last week I said, Jesus asked each one of us, who do you say that I am? This is put in the you again. If anyone wants to be my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. If you want to be my disciple, you have to deny yourself and take up your cross and follow me. Not the same cross that Jesus bore. Jesus bore the cross that meant he took on all our sin, all our shame, all our guilt, everything that we had ever done wrong. Jesus took upon himself on that cross, put it on his shoulder, walked to Calvary, and they nailed him to the cross. But we have to pick up a cross of our own and follow him. Doesn't mean for the world. It means that we've got to say that what Jesus asks of us is more important than anything we give ourselves. It's tough, isn't it, though? Now, I said I had some stuff planned for the kids. So you get to be kids this morning. I was going to bring a rock. I forgot the rock. There was a brick downstairs. I thought, I'm not going to carry the brick up there. I drop it on my toe, I'm sure. But rock or stumbling block. You got a friend, somebody that you go to school with, somebody in your class, if you're a little kid. How many of you remember being a little kid in school? Anybody can remember that? Pat does not have his hand up. You can't remember being a kid? I'm sure you can. Just everybody be a kid for a minute. You're 8 years old, and there's going to be a party at your house, and your mother says you can invite the whole class, but people don't like this one kid. Who's funny looking, maybe smells a little weird, maybe dressed a little crazy. You don't want to invite that kid because your friend says, if you invite her, I'm not coming to your party. Did you ever have anybody say that to you? She's invited, I'm not going to be there. And they all get together and say, either you have her or you have the rest of us. Which is the stumbling block? Which is the rock? What do you say to that one? Do you invite this kid or do you leave this kid out? What? Invite the kid. That's the way to build a kingdom of God. But if you want to be a stumbling block to God's purpose in life, just say to that kid, I don't want you there. I don't want you in my party. Now, the story that made me pick on poor Joel Osteen was the one about the Hannah Montana. You remember Hannah Montana, Miley Cyrus, before she was a little bit crazier than she is now? She was Hannah Montana. And she did concerts with Hannah Montana, and they were very expensive, and they were always sold out. He told the story. The one Joel Osteen sermon I listened to all the way through, I thought, wow, this guy's got this huge following. I don't understand why. Because he said his family wanted, his children wanted to go to the Hannah Montana concert. He said, we cannot possibly afford that. Get it out of your head. But somebody heard him say that and bought him tickets, front row seats for his whole family. And not only front row seats, they gave them the airfare to travel to the concert. When they got to the airport, they had a stretch, not a limousine, a stretch limousine to carry the five of them to this concert. And he said, that was a sign of God's providence. I thought, no, that's a sign that you got no sense, boy, because you want this to be what Jesus is about. I'm sorry, that does not work, does it? Is this life a free ticket to Hannah Montana? Is that picking up your cross? No. To pick up your cross is to say to your kids, we can't afford it, let's go someplace we can't afford. And explain to them. Now, people in my congregation had a daughter who was 15 and wanted everything she saw in the world. And they couldn't afford everything she saw in the world. She cried and said, my friends have it, why can't I? And they sat down with her and they said, this is the bills, this is what we bring in a month. Let's see where we can find the money. And from that day on, she went out and got herself a job and help support her family. Now her parents didn't take her money, but they said, save it for yourself, save up and buy the things you want. But But it gave her a lesson in what it is to be a responsible human being. Now, she is a responsible human being. She owns her own home. She's got a cat that she takes good care of. And she goes to church and works with kids every Sunday of her life because her parents showed her what it is to pick up your cross and follow. So what are we going to do here? We're going to pick up our cross and follow. We're going to sit and say, Jesus, hand me what I want. Now, Moses seems like a strange story to put with this, but it's really not. If we go back and look at Moses, because last week, what do we say about Abraham? Remember the rock from which we were hewn and the quarry from which we were pulled? Abraham being that rock, the original rock that we built our faith on. Because what did he do? God called him and he went. Now, this is many generations later that we've got Moses. Now, if you look at the lectionary, the way the lectionary is set up, there are four lessons every week. But during the summertime, we have the semi-continuous Old Testament lesson, because sometimes preachers pick the Old Testament, they'll go through a whole story. One year is David, this year was the patriarchs up through Moses. But we're going to pick this one up today because I think it does go with the other lesson, because Moses is keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. Moses is an escaped convict at this point, isn't he? Because he had killed an Egyptian soldier. He ran off to Midian, married Zipporah, and he works for his father-in-law. He's an older man at this point, just sort of like Abraham at that point in his life when he was called. The angel of the Lord appears to him in the flame of fire out of a bush. He looks at the bush was blazing and it was not consumed. And one thing I read this time in a commentary that I didn't know before, they said this was just a scrappy little tree. It's not some big, giant, beautiful shrub. But some people even said it might have been burning forever, but he was the first person to look at it because it says, he saw and he turned aside to see, and God called to him out of the bush when he saw that. Because he sees Moses look and he says, Moses, Moses, here I am. He says, come closer, remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. He says, I'm the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. Moses hid his face for he was afraid to look at God. Because the ancient Israelites thought if you ever saw God face to face, you were toast. Literally, it was going to melt your face. Sort of like think Indiana Jones in the temple of whatever. But here we are with God face to face with Moses speaking from the bush. This is the important line of scripture here. I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their sufferings, and I've come down to deliver them. You know how long it had been since Joseph was in Egypt? How long was it between Joseph and the people being enslaved? Anybody have any idea? Was it a short time? Was it a generation? About 400 years. They'd given up on thinking God would ever hear them again. But it says, if you look at chapter 2, it says they cried out, not to God, they just cried out in their suffering, and God heard them, and God came down to deliver them. God says, I know their sufferings. Know is an interesting verb in Hebrew and in Greek, translated from Hebrew. Adam knew Eve, and what did she do? She conceived and bore a child. That's how this verb is used. It means to participate intimately with someone else in something. So for God to know our suffering means that God suffers when we suffer. God knows our suffering and has come down to deliver us. How does God deliver us? He looks at Moses and says, this is what I need you to do. Moses is called to pick up a cross before there's even a cross to pick up and follow. And Moses says yes. First he tries to talk himself out of it, doesn't he? He's like, I don't speak very well, and I know that feeling right now too. Not to be able to articulate when you want to be heard and you can't speak clearly is very frustrating, especially for someone who talks for a living. Really frustrating not to be able to speak clearly or to slow myself down when I'm running out of air right now. But what does he say to Moses? Take your brother. He can talk for you. That was the first one. And then he says, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? If God said to you, I want you to go to the White House and confront Donald Trump or Joe Biden or whoever is in power, what would you say then? Right, God, I'm going to be arrested before I get to the door. But this is Pharaoh, the most powerful man on the planet at the time, and he's sending a convicted felon who has escaped back into the fire to say to the Pharaoh, let my people go, let these slaves go. Pretty steep asking of God, isn't it? Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh? And what does God say? I'll be with you. I will be with you. I will be with you. Moses says, if it comes to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your ancestors sent me, they ask, what is his name? What shall I say to them? Most audacious line in all of Scripture is, what shall I tell them your name is? Because you don't ask God's name. What is God's name? I am who I am. This is the original big T theophany here. This is God saying, this is who I am. Just as Jesus, remember a few weeks ago when we read about him walking on the water, says, this is who I am to the disciples in their fear. God says, tell them I am has sent me. Now, Jews will not even say the name Yahweh. And now the Roman Catholic Church is following the Jewish tradition of not using the name anymore. When I was in college, I had a professor who was Jewish by tradition, not by faith. He used to say to me every year, he said, Easter, isn't that when Jesus comes out of the hole, and if he sees the shadow, you have 6 more weeks of Lent? No, sir, that is not what Lent is, not what Easter is. He could be a little irreverent, but you know, when he wrote to me for years until his death a few years ago, he would send me emails. He would never even write G-O-D, he would say G-D, because it was too holy even to speak for someone who had lost his faith through the years. Such a holy name, I am. What does it say? This is the God who is, who was, who is, who always will be. We know God by his actions. We know God by his presence in our lives. We know God by his power. We know God by his promise. So he says to Moses, I've come down to deliver them. This is what you're going to do. And God is still saying that to us today, isn't he? You got to pick up your cross and follow. You can't just expect everything to come your way and be all rosy and beautiful and wonderful. You've got to pick up your cross and follow. No matter what God asks you to do, pick up your cross and follow, knowing that God will help you lift that cross. Because you're not doing the cross that Jesus did. You're doing the cross that was meant for you and you alone. Now, it doesn't mean suffering for suffering's sake, because it talks about, I've seen their suffering, and some people raise suffering to an art form, don't they? Someone once said to me, my curly hair is my cross to bear in life. And I said, seriously, your curly hair is your cross to bear in life? She said, yes, it is. I thought, you don't know what a cross is if you think it's your curly hair, lady, because you can buy yourself a little straightener and straighten your hair if you want to. But it's saying that you got to keep walking no matter what happens. And this is not talking about suffering for suffering's sake. It's not picking up a whip and beating yourself with it. This is not meaning you have cancer, you're suffering for Christ. You should smile and go along with it. So one of my congregations who on a retreat said, now if God sends you to a dark, dangerous neighborhood in the middle of the night and gives you a flat tire, you have to stop and thank God for that flat tire. I said, God does not give people flat tires in the sunshine, much less in a dark night in a dangerous neighborhood. It's not suffering for suffering's sake. It's not being sick. It's not the kind of suffering. We're talking about taking on the cross of Jesus Christ, which means if somebody says to you a racist joke, you don't just laugh and go on your merry way. It means you say to them, I'm sorry, I cannot listen to that. It means you say, I'm not going to be part of this anymore. I'm going to change my ways. I'm going to do what I can. A church conference is coming up, and every year we're asked the same question. And so far I've said, I don't think they're ready yet. The question they ask, are we ready to become an anti-racist congregation? Not as individuals, but as a congregation, are we ready to take on racism together? What should I say this year? Do I say yes? Do I say that we're going to be the rock that Christ builds his church? Or are going to be a stumbling block and say, I'm not a racist. Don't call me racist. I never call anybody a racist. It's not about individuals. About together saying we're going to take a stand in this community and say that this is wrong. We're going to take a stand together. Are you ready to say that, or do I say we're not ready yet? I see your hands. Are you ready to say, go on record and say, I'm an anti-racist congregation. Raise your hand. Looks like most of you are, it looks like. Maybe I'll do a different answer this year when the SPRC goes to that question. Because we need to take a stand for Christ in the world. We need to take a stand when people are suffering and dying. There's a lady we've helped here so many times. Her name is Sonia. We've helped her. We've put her up in a hotel to the point that we can't afford to do it anymore because she's just, we've exceeded the amount of money that we said we could use to help one person. But Sonia, her son died last year, and just a few weeks ago her husband died in that hotel room with a heart attack. And she called and asked for help. We get her a bus pass. We get her a little food, things like that. In the name of Jesus Christ, we help her. Kara and I put her up in a hotel one night. Kara paid for one night, I paid for the other, because we had run out of options for the congregation helping her. But helping someone like that is what we're called to do, to stand on the rock. Michael, who used to come at 9:30, hasn't been here in a while because he was sleeping in his car sometimes in a hotel, mostly in his car. We have folks like that who will walk to get here to worship with us. We're going to make a difference in their lives, or are we going to just be about ourselves? That's what the difference is between being a stumbling block to someone's faith and picking up a cross and walking, and being the stone upon which Christ can found his congregation. We're asked to do a lot in the world, aren't we? We really are. We're asked to take stands that make us unpopular and sometimes get us hate mail, said the woman who got hate mail over her Joel Osteen comment. I shouldn't have said his name. But I did. Whoopsie, whoopsie. And those people left the congregation over that because they said he was a more godly man than I had ever hoped to be in my life. It's a hard thing to hear, but that's what they thought. We cannot be what the world says works, what the world says is profitable, what the world says is what you need to do. Sometimes you have to stand against the world and say, I pick Jesus Christ and Christ alone. Just as Christ came to us in the bread and the cup and will come to us again and again and again. Because Peter was at that Last Supper. What did Peter say at the Last Supper? Even if they all fall away, Jesus, I'll follow you, even if it means I die. And Jesus looked at him and said, Peter, Satan's going to sift you like wheat, and you're going to deny me even knowing me three times before the sun rises, before the cock crows. And still he turns to him and says, what? Here is my body, here is my blood given for you. That's what Christ does to each of us. He comes to us in our brokenness, in our hot messness, and says, here I am. I will come with you. All you need to do in return is pick up your cross and walk to me. Because what does God say to Moses? I'll be with you. I will be with you no matter what. I will be with you. It's all I need to get up and go when God calls me. I hope you will walk too. Amen, amen, and amen. Would you please stand?